thank you to my panelists for joining me this morning. It's very welcome to have you here. It's great to have such expertise gathered. So in terms of these panelists, so we firstly have Roy. So Roy Lacey is a senior business analyst in KBC in Ireland, specializing in cards, but also with a wealth of payment experience. We have Shelley Shaktakam, who is currently working at Mode Global, recently joined, and congratulations on that. So she's head of compliance there. The SMF 1617 is just financial conduct authority terminology for money laundering responsibility and compliance responsibility. I can't remember which way around they are. Thirdly, we have Francis Clary, who is the co-founder of Exendar, which is an independent compliance consultancy. Again, Francis brings an absolute wealth of experience in the payments domain, so it's great to have you there. And finally, we have Joël Winteregg, who is the CEO of NetGuardians. And my name is Roy Bellchamber. I work in the product management team at NetGuardians. And today, hopefully, I'm trying to build a decent and interesting dialogue and steering the panelists. So without further ado, let me stop sharing that. And maybe if I can, I guess, set the scene to start with. And to talk a little bit about what we mean by faster payments or instant payments. So I guess it may surprise some people to realize that the first instant payment scheme actually was created as far back as in the 70s, in 1973 in Japan. The first scheme in Europe was in Switzerland, as it happens, in 1987. And then I guess it would kind of be at the start of this century that it really started to kick off, and those schemes have proliferated across all regions of the world. And now there are around about, or in fact, probably in excess of 50 schemes either active in the process of being rolled out or in late planning stages. Most of those are domestic focused, some of them are not, some of them are cross-border, some of those cross-border schemes are also potentially more than just single currencies. And all of them are about promoting payment innovation, about driving the costs of payments down, about bringing low value and instant value exchanges, typically between consumers and businesses, but also account-to-account personal payments. They're great, you know, consumers love them, and the adoption of the schemes really goes to illustrate that. So they love the flexibility, they love the low or no cost, and they love the transparency. They love the convenience of knowing that they can pay instantly and receive money instantly. Businesses enjoy them for the ability it gives them to receive money quicker, obviously, better manage their cash flow, and also the irrevocability and, you know, the nature of those payments. And then banks enjoy them and like them for the innovation that it can bring and the ability to monetize around those payment schemes. But it comes with a risk, and it comes with various risks, but one of the biggest risks is the financial crime, and specifically the fraud risks. And so that's what we're going to drill down into today. And if you think about it, it's kind of logical why there's that risk. So we've got, you know, we've got a high number of users, i.e. attack targets. We've got potentially high values that can be exchanged, and we've got instant and irrevocable access to those funds in the case of the fraud. So first question then, and maybe if I can direct this in first instance to you, Francis,
yes.
Could you talk a little bit about what you see? In fact, sorry, I forgot to ask everyone to do introductions to themselves. Would you care to do that? My oversight, I must apologize. Maybe Francis to start with.
No worries. So hello, good morning, everybody. I'm Francis. I'm already more than 20 years active in the banking space, and most of the time it was in the payments domain. And there I implemented, I drafted new payments architectures, implemented new payment instrument types, like instant payments, but also new ways of payments initiation. And also with the aspect on security and compliance, make sure that everything gets secured and the customer has trust in his bank and his payment that is executed.
Thank you very much. Maybe Roy next. I'm just going in the order that they're appearing on my screen.
Sure. Yeah. My name is Roy Lacey. I'm working currently in KBC Bank Ireland as a lead business analyst for cards and payments. I've been here for the past 3 years. And prior to that, I was 15 years working in Bank of Ireland in a similar role, payments, cards and payments. So the last 3 years, I've predominantly spent working on Payment Service Directive 2, and we're finally near the end of that journey. So, yeah, that's my background.
Thank you very much. Shelley, a few words, maybe?
Sure. Hi, I'm Shelley Schechter Khan. I'm passionate about democratizing finance. I'm currently head of compliance for Mode, who are a London Stock Exchange quoted payments and Bitcoin organization. And previous to that, I was head of the UK Payments Authority's compliance function, Pay.UK. So I've seen both sides of the traditional ecosystem and the new ecosystems that are coming in. Thank you.
Excellent. Thank you. And Joelle, finally.
Yes, hello. My name is Joelle. I'm a co-founder and CEO of NetGuardians. And when I was a kid, I really wanted to become a policeman, but then I fell in love with computer science. And I discovered that you can stop gangster with computer tool in the banking payment. And then from university, I created NetGuardians with a friend, Rafael. And very happy to be on this panel and to be able to stop gangster with computer nowadays and not just with guns.
Maybe not quite as much fun. Okay, so let me reiterate that first question and let me pass it to Francis in first instance. So could you talk a little bit about the impact of instant payments to fraud? And I guess also maybe even the reverse, the impact of fraud to instant payments.
Yes, yeah, so with the arrival of instant payments and indeed what you mentioned, the irrevocability, the speed of execution, and also the availability of the money on the recipient's account, some fraud types became much more used. First of all, you had the authorized push payments, where someone is tricked into doing a payment towards the account of the fraudster, and then you can have a lot of triggers where you see high volume, high value, new types of recipient accounts in your banking system, and then you can have highlights. Okay, those are authorized push payments. A second fraud type that became much more used through instant payments is the account takeover, where the credentials from someone are stolen and used to make payments. The third type is a lot of scams around corporates. So the CEO fraud, mandate fraud, where corporate users are also doing payments towards fraudulent accounts where a supplier has changed his account, or unauthorized payments from, for instance, the account from the corporate to someone else. And which one that already existed for a long time being the money mules has been, since payments are there, we have, let's say, money mules, but those also became much more popular due to the fact of the speed of execution and the less time you have to build up a profile of someone as a money mule. That's what the most common patterns we see now in fraud types due to instant payments, in fact.
Okay. And Shelley, maybe next. Are you seeing evidence that the fraudsters are moving towards instant payments as their, I guess, you know, their tool of choice in terms of those attacks?
Sure. Well, frauders are always one step ahead. But picking up on the money mules, I think that we're already seeing the beginnings of, and we're likely to see a continuation of, the use of those mules is going to become slightly different. So it's going to be about getting crypto into the fiat ecosystem rather than getting dirty fiat into the clean fiat system. So it's going to be interesting to see with the traceability that there is within the blockchain. It's going to be interesting to see how the ex ante reviews of those transactions can happen in the space of a millisecond.
Yeah, it's a bit scary, isn't it? And I guess Joelle next. I mean, have you seen any evidence of changes in scams, or are we just seeing the fact that, you know, they're choosing instant payments as the vehicles, or is there any more sophisticated modus operandi in play here?
Yeah, I think UK is a great example that release a fast payment for retail new business innovation very quickly. And if you look at when it was released, and between 2008 and 2009, fraud losses grew by 132% between those 2 years. So it's fact that it's an enabler. Now, if we look at the modus operandi of fraudster, we can see they still remain the same type of scams. I think as Francis highlighted, account takeover scams and so on. But it's just for fraudster, it's just a great enabler because time is one key asset right now to stop fraudulent payment. And just to give maybe one very concrete example on a topic Francis highlighted on account takeover. I recently met a bank having manual control for fraud, and their customer were targeted with real-time phishing. Something very well known that you have access to tooling on the darknet. Kids can almost orchestrate such fraud, where you get the credential through a fake website. You can even go through the second factor validation of the transaction because it's real time. You can pass the QR code and things like that. I don't want to go into detail, but you can easily go through all the first line of defense steps. And for that specific bank, the way they stop it is because at the end, the customer say, it's too weird, let me call my bank. And they were able to stop the money because it was batch processed every 3 times a day and things like that. Yeah. Now imagine with real-time payment, it's gone. And that's really what is triggering great interest from fraudster into that technology, making it harder to catch. Faster.
Yeah, and if you think about it, it makes absolute sense, doesn't it? Especially as certain of those schemes are pushing up the transaction value limits on them. You know, if you look at that UK faster payment system now, you can transfer £250,000, you know, instantly. And certain of those schemes even have no limits at all applied to them. And obviously that brings risks there. So is that the same sort of motifs that you're seeing, Roy? Anything to add to Francis, Joel, and Shelley's comments?
Yeah, well, I would agree definitely with account takeover. It's what we are seeing massively on our side, and with credentials being so phishing exercises where customers are actually just getting called from fraudsters and they're providing not just their online credentials but even authentication credentials. So we layer on strong customer authentication, but then customers still not used to the fact that, you know, they're getting contacts from fraudsters and they're providing those strong customer authentication credentials. And I mean, they may not as well be there if that's the case, you know. So that's predominantly the fraud that we're seeing at the moment.
Okay, interesting. And, you know, obviously it comes at a huge cost, not only to those that are directly affected by those frauds, especially those sort of account takeover, you know, authorized push payment scams and the likes, you know, individuals, I guess. But also, if you think about it in terms of the cost to the banks to tool up to address that threat. So I was reading some statistics recently about the UK faster payments. Again, I'm probably going to be feeding lots of UK stats in here, and apologies for that. So it's costing them estimated in excess of £125 million a year to manage the threat in terms of fraud against instant payments. That's the cost to the banks. And if you look at that in real terms, the impact of the fraud is roughly £10, or equivalent of £10 per bank account on faster payments, which is a scary amount if you think about it. The losses last year were nearly 480 million, gross losses nearly 480 million. And again, to put that in context, £700,000 a day we're talking about there. So it's not small sums at risk here. So who would like to talk a little bit about the impact that it has on banks and how banks have had to tool up and reorganize to address the threat? Maybe can I push that to Roy to start with? Would that be fair?
Yeah, sure. Well, I guess it's a never ending story of as soon as we resolve one issue with fraud, we have to invest somewhere else because another door is open. And at the moment, that is faster payments in terms of that's where everything is moving. But also, massively in the last 2 years, we've seen a massive shift towards online spend and retail spend. So that's where the fraud losses are being experienced and card not present for us predominantly. Massive amount of investment in modeling tools and authentication systems that we've introduced. But as I said already, I mean, even if you can have the most sophisticated tools in the world, but ultimately the customer is going to give the credentials out to anyone. It doesn't make much of a difference. So I think one of the other things that we've invested heavily in, and which you can see across the Irish market as well, is communication to customers to just educate them on fraud. Because a lot of customers, you know, I mean, especially older generation, are not used to shopping online, and they're nervous about it, I suppose, but they're the ones that are getting targeted and getting hit the most. So it's yeah, a lot of time and money has been invested in communication to customers.
Yeah. Okay. Interesting. Any experience? I know you consult with a lot of financial services organizations, Francis. Is there anything that you're seeing, any trends in terms of, you know, how it's impacting them and what they're doing?
Well, fraud is not newer, but due to the real-time character of that new payment instrument, instant payments, I see the shift of where a bank implements their controls. In the past, you could implement your controls in the last step of the payment process, being payment execution, just before it goes out of the door. You had time. Three times a day, you do a clearing cycle, and you have time to validate it. But now, due to the real-time nature of instant payments, it's no longer sufficient to control only there. You have to, in fact, combine information, control the complete payment process chain, from onboarding of a customer, the invoicing part, request to pay, which is very popular now, into also the payment initiation. How is it initiated? Is there a deviation? So there I see that internally within the bank, they have shift of controlling only last step payment execution to start to control the complete end-to-end chain and be as soon as possible to detect something, an anomaly or errors in even the onboarding part.
Yeah, yeah. So just, you know, to stop the threat actors coming into the bank in the first instance, to monitor the payment initiation, but then also to look at it through its life cycle right the way through to a receipt by the recipient. Yeah, makes sense. Anything to add there, Shelley?
Yeah, sure. So I'm picking up on precisely that comment, is that the traditional payments ecosystems and those that enable faster payments have quite a lot of friction in them, despite the outcome happening instantaneously. And that friction includes costs. So we're also seeing both consumers and merchants are not really fussed about the way the outcome arrives. So with open banking, which I believe in the UK, we are in a pretty unique position to create a direct relationship between the merchant and the customer, and this is something we're expecting to see continue to develop around the world, because the security issues, the authentication issues, the availability of funds issues, there is a degree of security around those that is just completely different, and the rails are cheap to run on.
So going back to Roy's comment about kind of, you know, that customer education bit, you know, have banks got the challenge that customers really don't understand the irrevocable nature of these instant payments? They're used to coming from a world where there's time in that batch cycle, be it for, you know, traditional payments, or even in the card domain, that they're used to being, you know, protected against some of those fraud losses. And, you know, are we really going through an education program? And if so, what's the impact of that? I don't know if anyone would like to talk a little bit about that for a few seconds.
Yeah, sure.
So let me push it back to you again.
Okay, thank you. Yeah, so it's just, we're seeing that the providers of fraud detection tools, whatever those tools may be, are having to look really far down into behavioral analytics from the onboarding of the customer, from the pre-onboarding of the customer. And those behavioral analytics are creating layer upon layer of behavioral authentication on top of the automated authentications and the protections that we're all used to seeing, like passwords and codes. So how you behave, if that's not going to be consistent, the machine learning that's taking place around that is really exciting. It's a bit like Minority Report come to life.
Yeah. And I know you've got direct experience of some of these things, Roy, so it'd be interesting to get your view on it. So I'm assuming that KBC went through have quite a lot of spend in terms of customer education, making them aware of these scams and how not to fall victim to them.
Yeah, and it's constantly evolving. So as an industry in Ireland, there's been a kind of a joint communication, not just from KBC, but from all the banks, to just explain to customers of the new layers of friction that were coming along. But the biggest problem that we kind of came across as an industry was merchant readiness, because a lot of the merchants weren't ready for that additional layer of friction. So we had to kind of delay and have a phased approach for the implementation of PSD2 to the last leg of PSD2, which was the strong customer authentication, which is, we're nearly at the end of it now. I think the end of June should be when it's fully live. But there's been a lot of work working with acquirers and schemes to try and get the merchants to a point where they're ready to for the strong customer authentication. So that's been our biggest struggle, but we're, as I say, we're nearly at the end of it now. Albeit there are still quite a number of merchants that are not quite there yet. But yeah, that's where we're at.
And do you think, Francis, that the industry, the banks, are doing enough to protect the interests of their customers, be they individuals like you and I, corporates, merchants?
Well, they're definitely spending enough in terms of the different tools that we've implemented. I mean, it's always a balancing act between, having a smooth payment process and then protecting the customer and the bank from fraud. So I think one of the key tools that any bank can use in the authentication stage is the risk assessment and behavioral analytics and the different models that are used and how they can reduce the number of challenges and reduce the amount of friction that you're introducing into the process. That's helped us massively, because we would have obviously, strong customer authentication, as others have said, is an additional layer on top of all the existing fraud tools that we would have already had in terms of card blocking, real-time authorization decisioning. But this is another layer on top of that. So having the behavioral analytic tools in the background to only challenge where we deem the risk appropriate, it has helped us massively.
Yeah, and did that kind of support what you see and hear when you're out consulting with your clients, Francis?
Yes, indeed. So more and more the behavioral analysis comes in mode to do. Also, they have more and more the tools to do it and combine different sources. But like I mentioned before, and also like Shelley, is the onboarding part, the onboarding part and the provisioning part, where you see your authentication mean or the credentials there, the customer must be trained much more to be careful with that, how they share their details, how they do it, and there banks can help having more information in the onboarding part and how to work with your credentials that you receive or the authentication means that you receive. And also to pick up on a point of Shelley is that indeed we are evolving towards open banking, platform banking. That means in fact we are evolving to more towards ecosystems. And there where also banks can help with the e-commerce providers is to share data. How can you detect more fraud is when you share, for instance, as banks together, recipient accounts, which are new, where you see a lot of volume coming to. Where you see for the invoicing fraud, where you can share, for instance, originating data together. Yeah. And that will help the open banking community, our customers, and need also the e-commerce platforms to create trust.
And are you seeing more of an appetite to adopt those types of sharing techniques?
Sharing techniques, for instance, in Belgium, you had a blockchain initiative between the four largest banks called Cube, where they share the onboarding information that was used for corporates to speed up the process of opening accounts at other banks, but also have a verification process which is shared between banks. So in different countries, I see more and more sharing initiatives popping up.
Okay. And would you agree with that, Shelley? Do you think it's just going to get more prevalent, or do you think there's going to be blockers and inhibitors?
Well, we have the blocker and inhibitor of privacy regulation and legislation. So I believe it's really up to the lawmakers and the regulators to carve out allowances, because I think we have these priorities of privacy and banking efficacy, and someone's got to make the call on which one's going to take precedence, and that hasn't happened yet. So we just tiptoe around for now, and yeah, it would be good to have a policy call on that.
Yeah, okay. And I guess, you know, ultimately it comes down to, you know, education. You've got to have the right processes in place, you've got to put the right controls in place, and you've got to have the right mentality in your organization. So I guess, you know, and it's always going to be a balance between, you know, the friction that you introduce by additional controls, you know, especially if those controls are customer facing. So if you're demanding the customer participate in your fraud fighting, then you're pushing the onus on them. You know, if it's an authorized push payment, for example, and they're being subject to a scam there, are they going to do anything other than to say, no, it's a genuine payment? So I guess maybe Joelle on that, you know, what do you see that we can do to reduce the friction, as, you know, whilst maintaining that excellent customer experience that we expect from instant payments?
It's really hard to find the right balance. And I think also we touch base on education, and we scam and love scam and investment scam. It's very hard because people are convinced on this authorized push payment many times. They are convinced that they are doing the right things. And we even see that banks are telling, not just by clicking on a button, calling sometime a customer, saying, are you sure you want to do this investment? We have a proof point that this account is used by fraudster, but they want to continue because they believe it's about genuine payment, genuine transaction they are doing. And I think also to link back to this question to education, it's a pity a bit in the world we are living that we should not trust anything coming out from people we know, coming out from a mobile device and stuff like that. And yeah, I mean, it's a bit a pity because we are losing this kind of trust we may have between people, because there are so much of these well-orchestrated scams that are being a very hard balance to find in between trusting a payment you are doing, trusting someone on the phone versus allowing a payment to go. And I think that education is a big part of it, and also having the bank the ability to add some feedback on suspicious behavior that are explainable, that you can explain easily to me, to anyone, why this payment is strange, giving proof point and not just asking for a validation with a rule on an amount, on velocity, or just timing, where at the end I just click okay, such as all those cookies GDPR that are coming on any website I'm browsing today. And the risk is that we are moving in clicking and moving on, and that's in kind of those real-time account takeover I highlighted earlier, that's just how it's happening. People are clicking OK without really thinking about what is behind. So I really think it's a balance between detecting things, that's for sure, but then also finding the right way to inform the customer, where is really the human are at the end, the weakest point of the chain. And that's where also a lot of work is needed, I think.
Yeah. And yeah, that's from, you know, the point pre-transaction, you know, when you're onboarding your clients right the way through transaction initiation, making sure that, you know, you can do your best job to validate the identity of the person, you know, to the level that you can, that you're sure that they are who they say they are. But also that still leaves a role for kind of, you know, I guess the stuff that NetGuardians do, you know, the behavioral profiling, the anomaly detection using machine learning and AI. Is that something that you've got direct experience of having worked with banks on, Francis? And if so, could you talk a little bit about, you know, sort of the journey that they've been through over the years?
Well, indeed. So first, it was, like I said, the control, the focus was on the payment execution step and gather information there, and then move away from the rule-based systems, which can detect some patterns. And the challenge was not only moving away from payment execution towards to more upfront in the chain payment initiation onboarding, but the challenge is to combine and have all those different types of data sources together. And most of the standard rule-based engines were not fit for that. So banks had a lot of, it took years for many banks to create a sort of data lake where they can combine those types of sources, different data sources, and use and apply a machine learning on top of that. That's a challenge that started 5-6 years ago, but still not finished. And hopefully we also have, let's say, more and more push into with more richer formats, richer payment formats to initiate. Much more data that can be executed, like in SEPA, it's a richer format, but you have the SWIFT, where they will move to ISO 20022, where there will also be more data in it. This will help to feed those machine learning systems.
But we
have a legacy in the banks. Everybody knows that you have to deal with it. That will not change.
Yeah, exactly. And maybe Joël, next question, you know, it's not easy, is it? So, you know, doing this in an instant is not easy. So perhaps you could talk a little bit about the approach that NetGuardians takes to this, why we approach it the way that we do, and what you see as the advantages in that.
Very happy to do so. And I often use the image, maybe bankers does not like a lot, that protecting a bank is sometimes like protecting a nightclub. It's not because you have a big guy in front of the door checking the people who can enter, such as the onboarding topic we discussed, that you don't need a security guy inside to look at suspicious behavior, to stop issues before they arise. And I strongly believe, also to join Francis' comment, that this behavioral approach into analyzing payment before they are released is a key step. And basically, with real-timeness, it's bringing more challenges, because those data lake that were built more statically, because it's hard to feed data in real time, is another type of architecture, are then getting ready, but then you can just run it that into batches approach, and it's very hard to answer real time to a payment and things like that. So I think that's the complexity it starts bringing. And I believe there are ways to solve that. And if we quickly look at what we do and how we solve it, basically, our approach is to enable learning, real-time learning, so data feed and integration is very key, such as also having predefined models, so meaning that you avoid running 2 years of data science project before stopping fraudulent payment. You need it today. Real-time payment is starting today. So that's really a key asset to bring to banks. And then the way we learn, for instance, just to give an example, is very important, because we are profiling behavior of each customer of the bank. So for instance, we've got Francis' profile, how he's behaving in regard of payments, his end of month payment, his loan, his lease, and all these activities he's getting. We are comparing, sorry, Francis, to use you as example, but we are comparing Francis to other customer of the same bank, just to see, okay, is it coherent? And the next step we are putting in production now on our cloud approach is to compare Francis' profile and within the Keys bank, but to compare his approach, his payment to other banks. And we are coming to the regulation point from Shelley in that case. But that's also really how we see the future, what we are building, because that really enables this collective intelligence. And that's, I think, a key asset we need to use, mainly also around a real-time payment, because everything is faster, and basically you need to be more accurate and to stop more fraud. So I think that the good news is that also we are moving out of this pattern of creating fraud detection solutions that are based on rules, where it's the endless story of the cat and mouse game, where you build a rule, the fraudster, they find another way to trick and to get out of that rule, and it's a never-ending story. So I would say the good news is that we are learning from behavior. We have ability to, you can do it real time, but you need the right architecture. And once we're gonna have a better community around it, we're gonna have the same power than fraudsters that are very well equipped, that are working in community on the dark, and that they are organized as a service. You know, you can rent a mule account as a service. You can do an account takeover as a service. It's not just a company in the world that are doing that. They are so much organized. And I think collective approach that we are also launching will really help us on having right tools around that.
Okay, excellent. And so then maybe let me pass it to Shelley. So is there anything to add to build on that? And maybe I can also throw in a question while I'm at it. How can a firm have confidence that the controls that it puts in place, whatever they are, but you know, these machine learning models, these AI techniques, how do firms know that they're doing what they expect them to do?
Okay, so I'm going to respond to that. What's great on machine learning is that you can look at the just about outliers and place the overlay of whether it's intuition or whether it's your appetite is adjusting. And what I love about Joel's approach is that he was a teenager and he thought up a solution to a problem that's been around for centuries. And the thought process that goes into shifting the entirety of the discussion to a new perspective is what I'm expecting we're going to see. So the controls issue will be, we won't have a control we report upon once a year to the board to get sign off report and accounts. We'll have a control that every day will show us the movement and the stats, and stuff will happen automatically as a result of reaching thresholds. So I really hope that's answered in terms of the controls and the automation, the embedding. That's absolutely key, because you cannot scale and you cannot monetize payments without having that fully automated in a way that feels secure. Yeah. Now, the second point onto that is the best way to feel secure is you get it right first time and you onboard quality customers. So at the moment, because of privacy challenges, we do that in a vacuum. We take people on as if they're fresh onto the world. We look backwards if we can at them, but it's really inefficient. So I'm just waiting for the social media firm to sell customer data with customers' permission, because they're going to be the monetizable customers, the safer customers, the authenticated customers, the customers we want. And that's going to take years to build up a profile. So until there's a way there to get around that little control, I can see us getting creative forever more going forward in terms of proving who we are to the financial ecosystem.
Yeah. Interesting points. Talking a little bit, so let's go into a specific case. So in the UK, over the past, I'm going to say roughly the last year or so, and again, Shelley's lived through this, so maybe she can comment initially to start with. So confirmation of payee is a mechanism to try and kind of at the point of initiation of that payment, validate that they aren't, you know, the payer isn't being subject to some sort of scam, you know, to tie up the account with a name on the account so that it isn't going to a fraudster's account. Is there anything that you can talk about there? Specifically, I'm interested in whether you see that as, you know, is it the silver bullet that's going to stop a lot of these fraud scams? You know, is it going to magically remove these risks?
So no, it's a great start. And that's all it is. It's a great start.
Yeah. Okay. All right. Short question, short answer. Well, long question, short answer. Okay. So Roy, anything that you kind of have a foot in both camps. So, you know, you've got your instant payment expertise, but you've also got a lot of card experience. So is there anything that, you know, these instant payment schemes can learn that would be transferable from the cards domain that has worked well?
I guess to echo what everyone else has kind of been saying around the richer enhanced level of data and real-time data to make the correct decisions and to know who you're dealing with and that it is a genuine customer. So, I mean, I've seen in the card schemes and card networks that they are getting to that stage where they are sharing across the different banks, or you can share across the different banks once you agree to it and sign up to it and pay for it, most importantly. The fraud data across fraud data and fraud experience across different issuers and different banks in terms of if you know that certain merchants are rogue merchants, if you know that certain IP addresses are rogue, instead of just relying on your own data, you're having that side of that data across other issuers as well, which gives you a much enhanced view of the world. And like others have said, it gives you a better chance of making the right decision.
Yeah. Agree. Do you agree with that? Francis, anything to add? Anything you see differently?
I want to come back to the point of Shelley and on the confirmation of payee. Indeed, it's a good start, but it's something that the banks really need to explore and offer more service towards that. It can be confirmation of payee, but also in open banking, banks can offer APIs to do a validation of the payer account number and the name. But I see now an evolution of instant payments because it's not only fast in execution, the evolution is very fast also. So like last month, Singapore and Malaysia implemented a cross-border instant payments between the two countries and two currencies, which is very, very new. But also what's very new is the way you can initiate a payment using a mobile number. So the challenge of identifying a customer that is really a customer that you know. Most of the banks rely on the account number. But we see now, like in Asia, but also within Europe, you have the SEPA proxy lookup scheme, SEPA proxy lookup, meaning, okay, can use other IDs. So it becomes more and more a challenge to really be able to 100% surely identify your customer using different IDs. Well, because once it's accepted, it's executed, and the guy has the money.
Yeah,
exactly. So I've seen confirmation of pays or APIs like on the validation. I see that a lot of effort still needs to be done to make sure that this fraud enabler can be blocked, in fact.
Yeah, and just to feed it in as just another data point, another signal, another scoring element into the overall end-to-end processes.
But it's a lot of data points now.
Exactly. Yeah, you know, it's only a job for machines. Can we talk, I'm conscious of time because I want to allow some time at the end for questions, but can we talk a little bit about, and I see Shirley smiling here, so let me push some questions to you, thinking specifically here of crypto and the crypto fiat, you know, border, can you talk a little bit about there? So, you know, are you seeing different threats? Are you do you think everything that's happening in the fiat world is also happening in the world of crypto, or are there differences in terms of the design that mean that you've got better protections in the world of cryptocurrencies? And I'm thinking here specifically, you know, with a lot of central banks around the world getting increasingly interested in exploring digital currencies.
Sure. So we are seeing significant exploration, and central banks and regulators are struggling to quickly catch up with crypto. I think in the UK we've had specific focus from the FCA, so they're accomplishing this much faster than we're seeing in other jurisdictions. But then there's places like Singapore who are streets ahead of us today. But it's such a dynamic environment that can change by tomorrow. So in terms of the fraud possibilities, identity theft, cardholder not present, lost card, stolen card, that doesn't exist within the blockchain ecosystem. And the fascinating thing about why blockchain was initially so attractive to the criminal underworld is that these transactions can be anonymous, but they are not private. And so you can have anonymity, but whilst ever there's no privacy, you're just cashing your anonymity. So in terms of being able to detect, because of the immutable nature of the Bitcoin ledger, you can't change a transaction. You cannot fake where it's been to or come from. You cannot fake the exchange rate because the timestamps are there. So in terms of altering what's already happened, that's a really, really tough thing to do. Mm-hmm. And in terms of looking into the future, well, we're looking to keep customers particularly safe because they're willing to come on this particular journey with us, which is the reduced friction and the sort of direct, it's me to a merchant or it's me to my final payee who's getting the funds through, and I'm not dependent on, I believe it's 16 different steps in the current UK payments ecosystem, all of those which need to be paid for as well.
Yeah. Anything to add there, Francis? I know you've got a lot of experience and, you know, particular interest in blockchain and digital currencies.
Well, definitely. The banks, the central banks are catching up mm-hmm. with offering CBDC, so central bank digital currencies, for the fact that you want to have the same experience like you have cash now, and also be sure that you can safeguard the anonymity of your transaction, but also the speed that you have in a cryptocurrency. So central banks are dealing with that, but I'm not only looking at central banks. It can also be a private initiative. We have seen mm-hmm. Facebook with its Libra, now called Diem. If they will not succeed, there are definitely others that will pop up, like maybe an Amazon or other, that will create what's called a digital currency area. And you will have then there the combination of using of cash, crypto, but also authenticated users, because Amazon knows them. I see definitely arrival of digital cash very soon, but with the aspect of anonymity in it.
Okay, interesting. Again, looking at the clock here, let's just try and wrap up so that we can then field some questions and maybe some closing items if we have time. So I guess, you know, it's evident that we're seeing, you know, a massive fraud threat on instant payment networks. And there's probably not a country in the world that's implemented them that hasn't witnessed this. Yet, you know, the levels of adoption, the use of these networks, but also equally the fraud risk rises. You know, is it just the cat and mouse game? What are we going to do? You know, is it ever going to be increasing fraud? Is it going to drive people away from using faster payments? Is it going to drive away countries from adopting faster payment systems? Anyone want to comment? Maybe Joelle to start with? I noticed we just lost Roy, unfortunately, yeah. It looks like.
I think on the faster payment impact is really like fraudsters are trying to buy time. That's basically the key asset. And if we just look at this famous Swift Bangladesh case that was a lot on the media some years ago, basically, if we look at what happened is that they initiated some payment on the start of the weekend on a Friday in Bangladesh, where it's weekend day, Friday there. They did it to the Fed account over a long weekend where Monday was public holidays in US. They had 4 days to make sure that they were not able to pick alerts. They deactivated some printer in Bangladesh to avoid printing alerts and stuff like that. So at the end, they just got 80 billion, if I'm right. But they are just doing that to buy time. 4 days was enough to get some money out in some casino in Philippines. So just thinking about that case and now real-time payment, you don't need anymore to buy time. You just play it when you want. And that's really where I see great asset into innovation service to customer, but that's really where I'm a bit worried on that, honestly, because then it really removes all these complexity to fraudster that they have mm-hmm. today. And the discussion we had with Roy earlier to compare a little bit with credit card business, where we are used to do a chargeback and all that. Credit card business is built around this trust, how you get money back. It's a full, at the end, it's all around that. And with real-time payment, it's more about bringing nice services to the customer without having a structured approach on managing those risks around, then that's where I see, unfortunately, a big opportunity windows for fraudster with an approach not as mature as card fraud in the way you get funds back, you reclaim, you get liability. All that is very well orchestrated by big players, where you don't have, you have point-to-point communication and fund exchange with a real-time payment. Where, you know, not banks are not organized like that right now, and that's a little bit, I would say, the sad point around that.
Mm. Anyone else like to give some final closing thoughts? Jelly, Francis, Roy, who wants to bite? I can't hear.
Famous.
Sorry, I lost you at the beginning there. Could you start again?
So I'm 100% sure that instant payments will stay and it will evolve even faster, because, like I said at the beginning, the e-commerce, the merchants also see the value in it, having liquidity, cash available immediately. So that's for sure. And then going back to the point of Joel, is that indeed the fraudsters don't no longer need time, but the banks need time to verify. So you cannot find any more time in the payment institution because money is gone. Banks are now looking, okay, where can we find in all the process time to control something? And there is the shift towards onboarding at the moment of initiation, like confirmation of payee is creating time. Sometimes when you have a new device that you want to register, put the device in quarantine for 2 days. So you create time over there for the bank to do some controls, because once it's executed, it's gone.
Game over, And Shelley had a hand up there. Maybe one quick point before we go to questions.
Yeah, sure. So I'm coming back to what Joel said about the pace of change. I have no doubt that what we've seen in the last 2 years will easily be matched in the next day in terms of advances, because this is the pace of change that we're seeing in creations of alternative ecosystems. And I'd just like to hear from people who are thinking differently about that.
Great. Great stuff. Thank you, everyone. We've had, I see there's one open question that's come in, which we can go to first maybe, but also I'm being fed some questions from my colleagues that have come in privately to them on chat. So we have a question from Marco here. I don't care who answers this first, you can fight over it. Do you believe that blockchain technology could be used effectively to secure payments without making an authorized push payment epidemic even worse to mitigate?
Yes
is the answer.
Okay. And for instance, also with the rise of digital vaults, where we talked about the privacy issue, but if a customer can put his data, like the account number, phone number, and his name into a digital vault, it can be secured by a blockchain, and he can also grant access to which he wants that can consult it. So I see also for a retail customer value in blockchain initiatives like digital vaults to secure my data and also to be used by payment service providers to control my identity. Yeah.
And do you think some of these sort of tools, techniques, initiatives from the, you know, the digital currency world and blockchain world could be, you know, could an equivalent be created and used in the standard fiat currency world, you know, standard payments world? And do you think that's going to happen?
There are proof of concepts, and that's the whole issue now with blockchain. A lot of proof of concepts. So it will come, but I don't know when.
Really soon. Right. Some other questions. I'm just reading them as I go. Let me just move this panel. First one. This is to Roy. It says, what are the best practices in terms of bank organization when there is a fraud or when there is a fraud alert in an instant payment environment?
That's a tough question. In terms of ourselves, we're only really introducing the instant payments, so we haven't really developed any. We haven't got the experience, I suppose, at that level to really highlight any particular learnings that we've got to date. We're much further behind than the UK are in terms of rolling out instant payments. So I can't really answer that with any real insight, I'm afraid.
Okay, all right. Another question here. This is a long one. So AI and machine learning are often a black box. It's hard to see why there's a fraud alert. So in the instant payment world, how can this really help? What type of AI system could be used? Maybe that's one for, I would guess, to Joelle or maybe Francis. Joelle?
Yeah, maybe to start on that one. It's true that we may see AI as a black box on how it links things together to detect fraudulent payment. But at the end, and that's where I believe there is great asset with payment and AI, is like you can explain why this payment is strange with basic things that are speaking to the customer. It's about your device is not exactly the same. It's about your location. It's about the amount you are transferring. It's about the country you are dealing with. It's about the time of the day that is a bit strange because you are not doing your batch payment on a Wednesday afternoon usually. And all that you can explain in easy way, even if behind the scene you have very complex learning techniques that are analyzing many parameters. With payment, you can speak about money moving that speak to people because it's day-to-day life. And I strongly believe that explainable AI through those parameters, so not trying to explain the bits and bytes behind, but then more the outcome, are really helping people understanding why this payment is blocked. And I think that that's also one of the key asset when we discussed about training, understanding, training end user and so on. That's also where banks need to provide easy way to explain things and not too complex and technical that just speaks to experts.
Okay, good. That was a two-part question and you happen to also answer the second part in matter of your normal flow. Anything to add to that, Francis?
No, that's okay. Very complete answer of Joel.
Okay. Great. I'm just conscious of time, and I think let's call it a day there. So thank you very much to my panelists for joining us today. It's been really interesting for me, hopefully for the audience as well. And so all I'd like to say is thank you and enjoy the rest of your day.
Thanks a lot.
For everybody.
Thank you.
Thank you.